a pleasure and an honor to get to share the word with you all this morning. So turn to your neighbor and say, if you ain't ready, you better get ready. So if you would like to record this on your phone, just don't blackmail me with it, okay? It's kind of hard to get it to each one of you when we do the whole conference, so you're welcome to do that. So I want to just talk just a little bit about last night. There's something that Nicole said that just resonated in my spirit, and it was what she said about abide, a willingness to continue in relationship. How many of us have a relationship? Yeah. But the problem is that we don't continue, right? We get derailed, sidetracked, blindsided, sucker punched, and we've lost our way. So I loved that, and I just wanted to remind us of that. All right, so what I'm going to talk about this morning, some of you may have already heard, some of you might need a refresher, it might be new to you, but I just want to give you a warning, you know, there's a warning on everything. It might come across a little abrasive, it might come across a little convicting, but there's no condemnation, right? So when the Lord digs, when he digs it up so you can go, ooh, there it is. I probably should deal with that. And so he doesn't dig it up and go, oh, look at you. He doesn't use it against you. He presents it to you to get it out because he's wanting to get the dross up. The scripture says he pulls the dross up so he can wipe it off so there's pure gold. That's the goal, right? All right. Enough meddling. Am I a little loud? I feel like I'm... Okay. We already talked about you had a good night, right? Everybody's good. Let's just pray. Let me just get my stomach settled. Father, we just surrender. So I'm not up here by myself. It's the Lord first. It's the anointing within. And it's the anointing that speaks to you through my voice. I've been carrying this for a long time. It's been in here a long time. And it's about to be birthed. And after that word last night that she gave our team, it's about to be birthed beyond this that we know. It's about to be birthed in regions and in nations. He told us to go to all the nations and make what? Disciples. It's not just for us and our four and no more. And when he births something, he births it through the atmosphere of heaven. And the angels' armies go and get it. And they go to make sure it performs what it's supposed to perform. Amen. Thanks. Whew. That wasn't in my notes. All right, Krista and I are going to talk to you this morning very practically. I'm not a preacher. I'm a teacher. I'm going to teach you something. And she's going to follow up with me. So we're going to talk about Eden Restored. And we're going to talk about pathways to holiness and a place of surrender. That's the ultimate. The Lord provided us a way to be whole. Amen. All right, Isaiah 51:3 says, "For the Lord will comfort Zion, and he will comfort the Lord. For the Lord will comfort Zion, and he will comfort all of her waste places, and he will make her wilderness like Eden and her deserts like garden of the Lord. Joy and gladness will be found in her, thanksgiving and a voice of melody." So, how many of you have felt like the last, 3 years that you've been in a desert? Right? Okay. Well, he made provision for that. All right, we're going to talk about I'm going to do the spirit, and so Chris is going to follow up with the body. The spirit of man. So Genesis 1:26 said, "Then God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness. Let us have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, over the cattle, over all the earth, over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth." How many of you know that you have dominion over all the creeps of the earth? You don't need self-defense. You have dominion over the creeps, right? Just get them. Tell Jesus to get them, right? Okay, so you've learned that today. All right. All right, Genesis 2:7 says, "And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils in the breath of life, and he became a what? Living soul." We are a spirit, we have a soul, and we live in a body. Why? Because God created us that way. Why? Because he's a triune being. Father God, the Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. All right, and then verse 8, it says, "The Lord God planted the garden in the east, and there he put man whom he had formed," body. Zechariah 12:1 says, "The Lord who stretches out the heavens and lays the foundation of the earth and forms the spirit of the man within him." We have a spirit. We have the spirit of man. It's the reflection of the Lord. He put that in us at our creation. So we have a soul. We are a spirit, we have a soul, and we live in a body. All right, the spirit of the man is the one that gives the believer the knowledge of God and bears witness to God through the Holy Spirit. So I like to say it this way. You know, when you make something, when a painter paints something, he puts his name on it, right? Well, we are stamped and sealed by the Lord. We are his. We're not anybody else's. So he put that place in there kind of like that's a stamp for him. His identity is in us. All right. Who are you? Who are you? You ever asked that question? Are you based on what you know? Or are you based on the truth? Because they can be different. It depends on who you're listening to, right? Who taught you about you? Yeah, we grow up some crazy ways, don't we? And it teaches us. We learn it. But it's not the truth. It's the way that we think. It's what we know. So our identity comes from school, PE. You know, I learned sex education at school, not at home. It probably wasn't the best way to do it. But you carry that with you. The first place that you learn it, it's what you carry with you. Amen? All right, so this is our original design. This is who we are. We are made in the image of God in his likeness, having all the same qualities, characteristics, and DNA as they do. We have dominion over all the creeps of the earth. We were given their power. Their power is Father, God, and Son, and Holy Spirit. To execute on earth, to multiply with being a standard of measure. We are a living soul breathing with the life of God in our lungs. We are only creatures created in the image of God. And their likeness having a soul. No other creature has a soul. We were destined to live in the Garden of Eden, and we were created to live in harmony with them, to be fully surrendered to this way of life, being a soul with a free will, unending, sanctified worker, complete, blameless, with understanding, intellect, creative, infused with life, illuminated with the lamp of God, divinely linked between natural and supernatural. Shout hallelujah. That's your destiny. That's your original design. You have the characteristics of your creator, not what you think. I came from, this is our original design. Let me finish my thought. There's no counterfeit. This is us. What I just read is us. But I got a counterfeit version of growing up. Because my daddy was a workaholic, and it was forceful or teasing. I never had the in-between, which cultivated an environment of rejection. So that was my knowing of my original design. And so when I started learning about the Lord, he's going, no, 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 baby girl. You weren't created in the image of your father. You're created in the image of me. This earthly father has defects of how he was raised. See how we're going to get to sin in a sec. But you see how it goes through? If we just settle for what we know, we're going to miss it. Because what we know is not sometimes the truth. Or it's a parallel to a truth. It's a half-truth. That's a counseling term. It's a half-truth. Well, a half-truth is a whole lie. Right? So who are you? And who told you who you are? All right. So we know all these characteristics. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father, for having the vision of me and you. And here's the thing about your soul. Your soul is like your thumbprint. So you, and you have a soul, but they're not me. My soul's me. So that's my personality. That's that original design that God created me. It's my eyes. It's my thumbprints. It's me. Then the Holy Spirit comes and partners, and then we express the Father through my, what he stamped me with. And you all are original designs. So stop loathing or stop being jealous of them, because they're their original design. Make sense? Because you're your own. You have a choice. You have a choice. All right, so everybody say thank you, Adam and Eve. Not. Genesis 3:1 says God placed in the garden Adam and Eve and two trees. Say Adam and Eve and two trees. He only asked them one thing, just one thing. All right, the tree of life and the tree of knowledge of good and evil. He instructed Adam not to eat of the fruit and from the knowledge of good and evil and the tree of life, or he will die. Oh, not the tree of life, the knowledge of good and evil, or he will die. Romans 3:14 says, for if you live according to the flesh, what you think, but if you live by the Spirit and put to death the deeds of the unsurrendered soul, we're going to talk about that. Sin nature, unsurrendered soul, sin nature, what you think, you will live if you put to death those. So Adam and Eve, neither one of them listened to God. Okay, I can say ouch there because Melinda doesn't listen to God sometimes too. Just don't eat the fruit. Don't go that far. Eve saw that the tree was good with food, and this was pleasant to her eyes and desirable to make one wise, and she took of the fruit and ate. All right, so what's the biggest impression that you have? You can drive by a coffee place and go, oh, hold on, let's go back there. Oh, my gosh, what does the restaurants do? Display their dessert at the front. Why? Because it plays on your emotions and your body talks to you and your brain goes, yes, I can't live without that chocolate pie, the whole thing. Right? I mean, our church has a bad habit. We serve donuts every Sunday morning. Donuts, donuts, donuts. You know, and I can be praying so holy and godly at home. Lord, I just thank you for this day and pray for the intercessors and please don't let me eat three donuts. And what do? Eat three donuts. So, you know, I want to ask Pastor Cody, can you just serve the holes? You know, there's nothing there. It doesn't work. All right, some nutritional bars would be fine, okay? So, I'll get off my soapbox. All right, so Eve saw that the tree was good for food. She saw, and it was pleasant to her eyes and desirable and make one wise. Oh, wait. Does the world tell you you can be wise by doing their propaganda? Be careful who you listen to. So she took it and she ate it. Sin. Man has now opened the door for sin to come into the original design. Whew. Basic Christianity. That's why we do what we do. it shifted our original design to a counterfeit. Right? Okay, guys, got to help me. All right, so they ate, and now they have knowledge of good and evil, which we do because we were born into that sin nature. And let me just talk about this good. You know, I hear people all the time say, oh, yeah, but they're good. They're good people. Blah, blah. Well, are they good for the Lord? You can be good and good yourself right to hell. Why? Because you ate from the tree of good and knowledge. Good doesn't get you to heaven. Godliness gets you to heaven, right? Sorry, Krista. They covered themselves and they hid from God. Okay, see what I'm wearing? It's an Adam's design. He was the first woman's designer clothing. Didn't know that, did you? Actually, God formed those leaves, and I call them the Adam covering. It's on the back right there. Otherwise, we'd all be here naked. Where's the guys? We'd all be here naked. Thank you, Adam and Eve. We have to have clothes. I said this morning, you know, guys got it so stinking easy. All they got to do is put on their underwear, their jeans, and their shirt, comb their hair, brush their teeth, they're out the door. I have to go to the paint and body shop for an hour. And Ralph goes, you done yet? No, still working. Takes a lot to look like this. You know, you got to have all those lights, you know, the body lights, you know, when you go in and get your bodies painted, you know, the car, you know, you got to see this stuff. All right. Then God, being all-knowing, came out among them. Oh, God, so gracious. I mean, he already knew where they were. He already knew when they sinned. He already knew when he was talking to him. He already knew what Adam was doing. Adam, you little slacker, get over there and take care of your woman. He's our covering. Go home and tell your husband to get to covering. Not how he thinks. I'm telling you that. All right, baby, not that way. The way that you haven't been doing it. Okay. Don't call me if it goes wrong. All right. Asking where they were, the story goes, and now sin has manifested out of the soul of man. Here's a newsflash. Say newsflash. What do we deal with every day? Seven sins, original sins, that we keep rehearsing back and back and back. There's only seven sins. Man, if we could get that. The first one is, I'm putting two together because they kind of mean the same thing. Disobedience and rebellion, hiding from God, fear, we blame the enemy, we conceal and cover, we blame God, and rejection. Now, if I was to dissect you, you know, of what your symptoms are and what you're going, one of those would be a fruit of what you're manifesting. Seven sins, thank you, Adam and Eve, that's what they did. Counterfeit fruit. Fruit from the tree of knowledge of good and evil. Do you see the parallel? We are an original design. We are equipped to do what God wants us to do. We know the story. God removed them from the garden to protect them from eating from the tree of life. If they would have stayed, in the garden in their sin nature and eaten from the tree of life, what would have happened? They would have been forever locked into damnation. No path of redemption. So what did Father do? He escorted them out, kind of gave instructions. Okay, now this is going to how you're going to have to live. And your little goober in the tree, get out and go on your belly. And he pulled them out of the Garden of Eden, and he set up a barrier and said, you can't come back in. Get this. What looks like rejection at times from God is for your protection. Man, I could get that. Telling me no again, it's for your own good, baby girl. All right, sin's effects on the soul of man. We're talking about spirit, soul, and body, a pathway to wholeness. Father God is coming back for a spotless bride. We have too much mold and creaks and crannies in our brideness. That's not a word. But when Adam and Eve were in the Garden of Eden, their souls were divided. I'm going to read this. I'm going to read it, and then I'm going to talk about it. Their souls were embedded in the spirit of man, and they were whole and one. When sin entered in, they separated. This is how I can get it in my head. In the Garden of Eden, our spirit and our soul was all meshed together, and we were in the body whole. They ate because the spirit is God's, right? The spirit of man is God's. The soul is what submitted to sin. It's like a nasty little sponge. Give me all you can of that nasty. So when they sin, it divided. Not, this is how I get it in my mind. They divided. Now the scripture says the what? The soul and the spirit are what? Enmity with one another. So they're vying to lead. So if our soul leads, we're going to go the soulish way. We're going to go sin nature's way. We're going to go Antichrist's way. If our spirit leads, our body follows. Then we're going to go the ways. So after sin, they divided. Now there's a competition going on the inside of you. There's a war going on the inside of you. Say, thank you, Jesus. That's revelation. You know, we're warring on the inside of us. Our bodies are warring because this isn't our original design. The beginning of the video, we are designed to be in the Garden of Eden. And our nature, our God nature, is crying out for that. But we're here, wearing Adam's clothes. So, when sin entered in, soul separated and become full knowledge of good and evil, now reflecting its new father. Soul's new father is the father of lies, not Father God. Soul is listening to its what it gravitates to, right? The sin nature. All right, having now an unsurrendered soul, so now my soul is not surrendered to the Spirit of God. My soul now is independent and works opposite of the Spirit. So it's in rebellion against God's original design, which we will find in ourselves today. If you have not been born again, we are full of sin nature. If we don't know the Lord, then our spirit at the fall, what happened to our spirit? It died. That's why we need to be born again. That's why we need to be revived from a death state. God said, if you sin, it's death. He can't go back on his word. He has to honor his word. We're in a dispensation of grace right now. That's why you and I can go out and sin, and at least yesterday, I don't know about today, we're not going to get zotted from God because we live in this dispensation of grace, right? We're graced right now. So if you've not been born again, we are living in a sin nature, and our soul is dictating us. It elevates self, pride, and all the works of the flesh and the sin nature. Everybody getting this? You getting it? So the spirit of man died. God said that sin leads to death, and he is not a liar. So he was held accountable by his own word, and he had to deal with their sin. And now the spirit of man needs a savior from death. Now I'm going to talk about the unsurrendered soul. Everybody get it, how the soul comes unsurrendered to the spirit because they were one? The Bible's all type and shadow. It's amazing. Remember in Genesis 2:9, God breathed the breath of Adam and became a living soul. His soul still lives, but it lives a counterfeit life. It no longer is an original, nor longs after the original state. The spirit does, but the soul doesn't. Now the soul's effect toward its father is affections towards its father is now Satan, which is the sin nature we war against every day. The soul now functions out of a sin nature, which is self-focused and pride. Now hear me when I say Satan. So I'm going to just rant a little bit. We have the influences of Satan, but there's degrees of principalities and powers. Most of the time, we blame Satan for our unsurrendered soul. And he don't have to do anything. So be careful how, yeah, we just really need an in-depth study of the levels of, We know it's the sin nature. We know he's the author of it and the father of it, but don't give him credit for over. Unsurrendered soul is the container that holds things from the fallen man, the attributes, the characteristics of sin, and now what it is desires is to express. It expresses the sin nature. It likes turmoil, drama, feeds on chaos, lust of all kinds, elevates above others. It blames, accuses, it complains, and it's never satisfied. It is always wanting. Right? Kind of like the scripture that says, a purse with holes, it's always empty. It always wants more. It's addictive. It's its nature. Because the characteristic of Lucifer fallen in Satan, he is addicted to get back what he forfeited. And who has it? We do. We have what he wants, right? All right, he's always wanting more. He's never satisfied. Our soul in this condition is corroded with the cares of the world and lust of the flesh. These characteristics are what drive the soul of man away from God. The pride of life, the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh are now at the forefront of the souls. Okay, I'm going to use coffee. Everybody like coffee? All right, back in 1925, there was coffee grounds that were nasty bitter, and they drank them. Fast forward 20 years, now we have flavored coffee. Fast forward another 20, now we got all kinds of foo-foo in our coffee. Why? Because what we have is not enough. We have to have different. We have to have more. We are never satisfied. It's our taste buds. You know, it's our flesh. What does he tell us to do? To be content in what? Every season of your life. So when we're not content, what do? Complain. One of the seven. Blame God. So I told you it's going to be convicting. The souls are sticky and obsessive. Always keeping a record of all things done wrong. It has a memory card of 30 to 40, 50 years of information stored in it. All right, personal testimony. I'll just be transparent. 2 years ago, I had a sucker punch. And I wasn't expecting it. I mean, I'll just say a sucker punch. Totally blindsided. Well, I had to work out of that. Me and Holy Ghost worked out of it. And it took me about a year and a half to go, okay, get your big girl panties on and stop obsessing. You can't change people, right? But if something comes up in the morning while I'm in my paint and body room, yeah, you know what they did to me. I'll think about that stupid thing all the way to Enid to work, drive 20 miles, don't remember any intersections, or stopping at any of those lights, get to the office and go, ooh. What has my soul done? Captivated me and held me captive. So now I wasted those 20 miles I could have praised God, because he'll come in and he'll use the same tool that created the wound in the soul of blindside. It was a sucker punch. He'll come in and do that baby sucker punch just to get my affections toward it. Do you hear me? And he'll captivate you for hours and miles. What's he doing? He's stealing your time. Can I have that 8 o'clock to 8:30 time again ever in 2022? No. We don't get to now the Lord says he'll redeem our time, but we don't get to relive it, right? So the enemy's crafty. We need to know that. He will plug it into your mind and cause you to relive the events of the betrayal that was been 30, 40 years ago and taking you down memory lane for hours. He has no mercy, grace. He is rigid and he's rude. In it is a place of all evil workings because it is now the ground for the enemy's influence. Our sin nature or our unsurrendered soul is no longer holy. It produces false humility, blame, shame, and guilt, all counterfeits of the original design. Sin in the soul's goal is to keep you from a place of surrender from Father, from finding out your original design. Because in the Word it says to renew your mind. Well, how do we know what the what the original design is if we don't renew our mind. The soul will blame everything, including the enemy himself, but he doesn't care if he can get your focus on blaming. He still has us held captive, not returning to the Father. We say a lot of times, oh, the enemy is kicking my backside. The enemy's doing this, the enemy's doing that. I've said it myself. Because we're going through a difficult situation. We're going, the enemy's doing this, the enemy's doing that. Complaining, critical, judging, accusing, prideful. You see, the enemy is crafty. He doesn't mind if you accuse them. This is an unsurrendered soul's way of not having to change. He likes how he is. She, we'll say guys, it's a women's conference. It likes how it is. And if it can get your subconscious to blame the enemy, your soul is going, woo-hoo-hoo, I still get to do what I want to do because I don't want to change. Y'all okay? I don't see any blood running. Jesus. Heal them all. Blaming is a deflection of the soul's condition and a need for a redeemer. If we blame, we are not looking at that thing and surrendering that soul to the Redeemer. This is why we can pray for things, change in our world around us. And if we continue to go around the mountain and go around the mountain and go around the mountain and have the same attitude, nothing changes, we might need to look at soul's condition. Is it fully surrendered and who to? Now, I can get crazy. I can worship the Lord and be in the anointing, and here comes this fleeting little, what about me? And totally pull you away. It's an exercise. He says to exercise yourself to godliness. That's your diligence to get this unsurrendered soul surrendered so you can be whole. And if you're whole, then I'm whole, then we can be whole together. And if you're whole and I'm whole, we can be whole together. And if you're all whole and I'm whole, we can be whole together. And the more we're whole together, the more we look like the spotless bride. Right? How can we go, and it's just for teachers, how can we go and expect for wholeness if the church can't be whole? We have to be whole first because we're made in the image of God. When we're living two personalities, when we're living out of the spirit realm, I call it carnal nature, carnal Christian. We're a Christian one day and we're a heathen the next, depending on who's talking. We're not a good reflection of who God is, right? The soul is made up of three parts, mind, will, and emotions. Everybody said hallelujah. I want to make sure you're awake. Hallelujah. Okay. Jesus, help me. Mind, will, and emotions. Our soul, so we have a spirit, we have a soul, and we have a body. Our soul is our mind, will, and emotions, which sin, that's where sin has effect on. It can affect our mind, our will, and our emotions. An unsurrendered mind is Romans 8:7-8, because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, nor indeed can be. It can't be. It can't be. It has to be surrendered. So then those who are in the flesh cannot please God. Those that are in the flesh cannot please God. If you're in the flesh and you're ripping somebody a new and you're not pleasing God, let me look up. Right? Jesus, help us. See, it's simple. We sugarcoat Christianity and we're just not real with ourselves, and that's the default of Christianity. We don't give the world a thorough, accurate replication of who Jesus is. Passion Translation says, the mindset focused on the flesh fights God's plan and refuses to surrender to his direction. God finds no pleasure with those who are controlled by the flesh. And here's a charge to the church. We better start getting correction back in the body of Christ. because we're all in bed with the enemy way too much. And that was pretty drastic comment. But we allow the enemy to be with us too much. We allow his influence too much. We allow him to be there because it's familiar with us, because that's the sin nature. The sin nature says, oh, that's okay, that's familiar. But we have to know when we say, draw the line, no, this is not godly. Come here, sister, let's talk about this and let's get this out. Gossip has to stop. Backbiting has to stop. Criticism and judgments. I have to tell you a funny story. My girlfriend from Alabama. Now, she can chew your butt out. And you'd never know it because she's laughing and carrying on. And you just got your butt chewed. That's how she rolls. So she worked in an office in Enid. And this one lady would come in chronically ever so often. And she'd talk about another lady, which was my friend's client. And she'd say, she did this and she did that. And she'd say, did you know she did this? Did you know she did that? One day, she had a feeling that that gossipy friend was going to come in. She scheduled that person that she was talking about that day. That's what she did. And she said, hey, here's so-and-so. You want to tell her what you've been telling her? Tell me about her? We laugh. But if she would have partnered with the gossiper, we would have partnership with the sin, because we're not protecting the body of Christ. You know, the Bible talks a lot about correction. It talks about iron sharpening iron. Get rid of our rough edges. Now, there's a time that you need to discuss things to know how to navigate and how to minister. But I'm talking about blatant gossip. Well, let's stop that lady from coming in. She quit coming in. No kidding. She shut her off because it was giving her energy, right? It was satisfying her soul. Ooh, yeah. You know, I get to go tell my friend, blah, 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 and this girl, she just shut it up by having that girl in there. You going to tell me what you've been telling me about her? Right? We can do this. Here's another pet peeve. If I ask you a question, don't sugarcoat it because you think you're going to hurt my feelings. If I'm asking you a question, I need the truth. You know, I need the truth. All right, I'll stop meddling. Say, move on. All right, unsurrendered mind. Did I read this passion? The mind needs renewing. It thinks what it wants to think. It wants what it wants, and it likes to be obsessive. Just like I talked about a while ago. I can think about something from 20 years ago and rehearse it clear to Enid. As we think, we'll determine how we change our physical nature of our brain. As we consciously direct our thinking, we can wire out, or partner with toxic patterns of thinking. You're going to get more on that in a minute. When we think, we build thought patterns with our mind, like to rehearse over and over, and over time, the unsurrendered mind will become substance in your brain that are not of God. The Word of God says renew your mind. Why? Because of that. Because it is full of sin nature, and our sin will always have affections for sin nature and carnal thinking. You know, the Word was written for us to become spotless bride and whole. Amen? Unsurrendered will. Remember, the soul is made up mind, will, and emotions. This is the most damaging of self-centered. This is the most demanding and self-centered. Unsurrendered will is the most stubborn, hard-headed, selfish part of our soul. The will has power. You've heard this, willpower. The will has power, and he'll use it against you. He'll use it against your God-given destiny and your blessed life. He'll use it against you. And if not surrendered to the Spirit of God, it will outpower you and get one it wants. Why? Because it wants control. Who's its father? What's the enemy wanting? Control. What keeps us from the love of the Father is what we will for. Learn of me, Scripture says. Do not be stiff-necked and hard-hearted. An unsurrendered will is a place of rebellion, oppositional defiance, critical negativity. If not satisfied, it can be jealous and offended, and it can be mean, defiant, difficult to work with, easily persuaded. And these are some of the rotten fruit in the unsurrendered soul that manifests. Our will functions like a steering wheel. It has the power to choose righteousness or selfishness. It has the power to follow Father God, or has the power to follow the father of lies. You know, when Peter rebuked, when Jesus rebuked Peter, and Peter said, you know, Peter said, "You're the Christ, the Son of the living God." And then Jesus said, "I'm going to die." And Peter goes, "No, you're not. We're going to build a kingdom." And Jesus rebuked him and called him Satan. "Get behind me, Satan." Why? That was Peter's soul. And it was the fruit of the soul's father. Make sense? All right, so our will is like a steering wheel. Self-focus can eventually, if not surrendered, lead us to self-destruction and can even wheel us into eternity without God. When Jesus was manifesting on earth, he asked those that were crippled and blind and ill, "What do you want? Does your will believe?" In other words, where is your will? Is it surrendered to me, or is it surrendered to your sin nature? You see, we have a choice. Where's your will? I will to eat those donuts or not? And how do I renew my mind? Let's just do that as an example. All Faith Center people are going to go, "Okay, we have to do what Melinda says Sunday." I can go in there and will not to eat them, right? But my will has the power, and it's going to go, "Oh, now it's okay. You can get size 14 jeans instead of 7. Because, you know, it's low fat. It's all going to go right here. Stupid liar. So how I renew my mind to that topic... How I renew my mind to that topic is, instead of my will just saying, "I will to do this, I will to not, I will to do this, I will to not," you say, "Holy Spirit, help my will." Because he said, "I do what I want to do, but I don't do what I want to do. I do what I don't want to do." That's what Paul said. That's why. So what I do is I say, "Holy Spirit, help me. This is what Melinda wants. I don't want to eat 4 flipping donuts at church Sunday. I don't want to do that. So, Holy Spirit, help me not to do that." And when I get Holy Spirit involved with my will and get my will surrendered to Holy Spirit, and I can check right by them and everybody's got chocolate all over their face and down there, you know, and I'm just going, "Yeah, you didn't talk to Holy Spirit this morning." I did. I don't really say that. I think it. So we have a choice. Emotions are tainted. All right, so unsurrendered emotions. Remember, the soul is mind, will, and emotions. You got it? We're on the third one. And I'm going to give you a handout to help you remember. All right, unsurrendered emotions after the fall of man. We're talking about after the fall of man before we're redeemed. All right, emotions are tainted by sin's nature, and they are sticky and attached to everything, and they are highly influenced to the sin nature. We live with damaged emotions, unhealthy emotions, out-of-control emotions, seeing life through colored lenses of damaged emotions. Our emotions are crazy. Jesus, help us. If we live with damaged emotions, unhealthy emotions, and out-of-control emotions, we'll see life through those colored lenses of damage. It's damage. It's damaged emotions. So as growing up, I shared earlier, if I come from a childhood of rejection because that's what that circumstance taught me, it wasn't the truth, but that's what that taught me because I didn't have healthy emotions. Now I'm going to put these lenses on that's going to attach to my ear. What I see is going to attach to my ear, and what I see is going to speak to me. So now, Tasha said something the other day. and it made me mad. And I felt rejected. See how it works? So your lenses will look for rejection, and your lenses, when it'll highlight it, it will highlight it because that's the enemy wanting to highlight that that unsurrendered soul part, and it's going to speak to your ear. Oh, she's talking about me. She's rejecting me. Girl, she didn't even say hi when she walked by. Lord, if I did that every day, I would just be on the floor just so rejected, because most people, I mean, you're busy. I can look right at you and not see you because I've got my mind going, oh, I got to do that. I got to do that. Left my phone in the bathroom. I don't know where it's at. Right? Okay. So we wear those lenses and it attaches to our ears. So what we see speaks to our ears. And then we have a choice to believe the lie or not. So we have to hone in our emotions. We wear our feelings on our shoulders. We will be easily offended and greatly disappointed. Never content, finding fault, judgment, criticisms, negativity, depressed, annoyed, out of control, irrational, difficult, always falling drama, which feeds our unsurrendered emotions. And the list goes on. Think about it. If we were in the atmosphere of heaven, and do you think there's drama in heaven? When you think about it, God wears you out, makes you feel nasty. You get home, lay your head on the pillow and go, why I feel so nasty? Because I've been satisfying my soul all day. Y'all okay? Our expectations are elevated to compensate for our emotional deficiency. They are hard to please and easily disappointed. We must manage our emotions by surrendering them to the Spirit of God rather than allowing them to manage me. If I don't surrender my emotions to the Spirit of God, I will get wounded every day. Because somebody's going to say something that's going to sound a little like that little wound of blank years ago. And it's going to he tries to use that against us. Our body can be healthy, our mind can be sound, but if our emotions are not surrendered, they will carry us on a tangent every day and wear you smooth out. And then we go, God, why aren't you doing something? God, why aren't you moving? And all the while, it's that part of my unsurrendered soul, right? All right. For example, they will not surrender on their own. We must surrender them and yield to the influence of the power of the Holy Spirit to draw them to a place of health. We need Holy Spirit's power. Isaiah 10:27 says, and it shall come to pass in the day that his burdens shall be taken away and off our shoulder, and his yoke from off thy neck, and the yoke shall be destroyed because of the anointing. You can remove that unsurrendered yoke. You can remove that unsurrendered captivity of your mind by renewing your mind, and the anointing will break that off, and you can walk a life with a sound mind, healthy emotions, a subservient, a submitted will, and walk in wholeness. There's a need to be restored by a Redeemer. God asked Jesus if he would be sacrificial lamb for the sins of the world, and he said yes. Thank you, Jesus. He said yes. You and I get all ticked off because we get accused of something we did. Jesus didn't do any of it and said yes. And Jesus ministered to those training and teaching in his ways of redemption. He was preparing for the ultimate sacrifice, his death once and for all. After the resurrection, Jesus told the disciples to wait until they were endued with what? What's first? Power from on high. He sent the Holy Spirit. Everybody say Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit's our Redeemer of the unsurrendered soul. You guys okay? All right, Luke 24:49. And behold, I send the promise, my Father, upon you, but tarry in the city in Jerusalem until you're endued with power from on high, clothed, equipped, empowered, half furnished with full power, which we know as the baptism of the Holy Spirit and the evidence of speaking in tongues. Galatians 5:25, if we live in the Spirit, let us walk in the Spirit. John 14:26, but the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father has sent in Jesus' name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all things that he said to you. Romans 8:14, for as many are led by the Spirit are sons of God. 1 Thessalonians 5:23, now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless at the coming of the Lord Jesus. 1 Corinthians 3:16, do you not know? Do you not know that you're the temple of the Holy Spirit and he dwells in you? Do you not know that the Holy Spirit is a third of the Trinity? The third of the Trinity. As a Christian, we must learn to host the person of the Holy Spirit, meaning cultivate and increase an intimate relationship with Holy Spirit so much that Holy Spirit will manifest his goodness by signs, miracles, and wonders, will expose the very nature of God through you. Wouldn't it be fun, instead of functioning out of sin's nature, the unsurrendered soul, is to just go, be healed, they're healed. I walk by somebody, my shadow healed them. Wouldn't it be fun to function in our original design? We can. We can with the help of Holy Spirit. We must pursue the Holy Spirit for no other reason than to have an intimate relationship with him. We pursue him with our hearts and our motive and successful for the sake of self, self-image, and effective ministry. With signs following only no real or deep relation, asking for nothing but just more knowledge of him. Then we develop a deep personal intimacy. What do we have? Okay, so I'm reading this. Let me tell you the story. If we don't go to Holy Spirit for intimacy and relationship, it becomes a business deal. Okay, follow me. It's a business deal. Holy Spirit, I need this over here. Go do that. I'm not intimate. I haven't given him time. Okay, think about this. What do we do? What's in our country that is intimate in a business deal? Prostitute. We prostitute the Holy Spirit. It's a business deal. What you can give for me, what I get out of it. I'm not connected. He doesn't want us to do that. And we do that when we follow our unsurrendered soul around. Holy Spirit is not something that we can throw over our shoulders like a backpack or a duffel bag and say, come go with me. Although he goes with you, but he's not. He wants to go with you. Not go with you because you're demanding him to go with you or fix all your problems when you're not going to fix yourself, right? Or help ask him to fix you. He is the person of the Holy Spirit. He is moved by our humility and willingness to lead. Do you know 90% of healing comes from humility? If we're just yield to that, it's just that inside of us yields, right? Holy Spirit is the gift from Jesus, and he is he, and he desires a relationship with those whom he is living. Anyone ever with someone that doesn't give you the time of day or make you feel like you're not in the room? Do we do that to Holy Spirit? We are not to respond to Holy Spirit in this manner. Holy Spirit's ultimate destiny is to cultivate an intimate relationship with us, and out of the relationship manifested is his provision. Here's his provision. He's a teacher. He's wisdom. He's revelation. He's a comforter. He's a helper. He guides us into all the truth. He empowers us to do the will of the Father. He convicts the world to sin. He gives us spiritual gifts. Holy Spirit is the seal to our lives of believers, and he helps us, the believers in weakness, and intercedes for them. He gives us new eternal life. He sanctifies and enables believers to bear good fruit in our lives. Holy Spirit bears witness with our spirit. We were talking about restoring Eden and the pathway to wholeness in Eden restored, cultivating a lifestyle of surrender. I just want you to put your hands out. So we're talking about a pathway of wholeness and restoring Eden. Eden is on the inside of you. And we can say it this way, Lord, restore my Eden. Restore my soul. My spirit man is hungering and thirsting after righteousness, but he needs all of me. So, Papa, bring your spirit and restore my soul. I surrender my soul to the spirit of the living God, and I partner with you, and I ask you, God, to forgive me for ever being lured away from my original design. And I declare today, you guys need to say this, I declare today that I am going back to my original design. I surrender my soul. Say it with meaning. Soul, shut up. Be obedient. Surrender to the Spirit of God. Soul, I need you to be whole, but I need you surrendered to be holy. Papa, I want to be whole. Holy Spirit, teach me how to be whole. Holy Spirit, convict me. Poke on my heart when I'm following the soul. I surrender that my Eden is restored. Father, I lift up every woman in this room and I declare, God, that there is a transition in our thinking, that there is revelation knowledge of how we're made up. The enemy isn't always the guilty one. Lord, I just declare that there is a reminder of the mind, will, and emotions, the spirit and the soul, that our soul needs surrender to the Spirit of God. And Lord, I just ask for a supernatural manifestation over all these women. God, give them revelation. Get the fog out of their head. Get the natural man out of their head and restore them to their original design. God, each one of them is needed in the kingdom of heaven. Each one of them has a design from Father that's needed in the kingdom of heaven. I thank you, Father God, that we can't do it with the one on our left or our right. We're all called as daughters of the Most High God. We're all made in the image of God's children. We're all God's children, and he needs each one of us. Lord, we can't do it by ourselves. There isn't just one in heaven. There's all of us. And it should be such a burning in our spirit that we should care if that person next to us is going to heaven or hell. Lord, I just thank you that there's a boldness in these women. As Nicole prophesied, she prophesied over the retreat team, but that was a charge for all of us, is that we're going to go out of our four walls and we're going to minister the gospel. But we got to be whole. We got to be healthy. We have to be emotionally stable, because you're going to run into some devils and demons that you don't know what to do with. And if you partner with them, then they're going to kick you outside of God's will. So we declare this over us now, God, to do a shift, to do a shift, to do a shift in our being right now, in the name of Jesus. Shift it in our mind first. Take care of our mind first. Teach us about our mind and how our mind leads us astray. And Lord, we just declare that over us now in the name of Jesus. And we say, Holy Spirit, come, minister, minister the gospel. Minister the truth. Holy Spirit, come and minister. Minister right now in the name of Jesus, how the mind is supposed to work. We ask you, God, that this will not be a difficult lesson, but we will get it in the name of Jesus. Holy Spirit, you're our wisdom and you are our teacher. And we're not going to say, oh, I don't understand that. We're going to understand it because the Holy Spirit understands it. And there'll be no more excuses, and there'll be no more blaming the enemy, so our soul doesn't have to come about, so our soul isn't helping. Accountable, we're going to start holding ourselves accountable. It says if you judge yourself first, you won't have to be judged. So we're declaring that over us right now in the name of Jesus, And we say, be it unto us, be it unto me, according to your word and my faith. In Jesus' name. Amen.